Good morning. Pleasure to be with you this morning as we worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And just a pleasure to be with you on this 4th of July weekend. And we praise God for this nation and for the country that we live in. And we just just rejoice in the Lord placing us here in this country to serve Him and to honor Him. So we're so grateful just for our nation, and we just continue to lift it up in prayer daily and just continue to seek God's glory in our land. Are there any announcements this morning that you would like to, anyone needs to share with us this morning? All right. Just a few real quick to touch on. The Precious Life bottles, again, those we need to be returned by next Sunday. So if you've taken one of those bottles, just please return it with the donation by next Sunday, and just to go and bless that ministry. Bible study will be finishing up this Wednesday night, so that'll be the last week for that session, and we'll look to have another one sometime down the road here, but for now, that'll be the last one. And some other announcements here as well. We continue to have record the service, and we'll be continuing to post that online, as well as if you know someone that would like a DVD copy of that, we can get that delivered to them as well. Also, in talking and looking ahead at for Vacation Bible School, some things we talked about with that, we are not going to have Vacation Bible School in person, and I think that's, I don't need to go into the reasons why for that. I think everyone understands that. That's just where we're at, and we're not going to be able to have it in person, but we are going to look to do an online format of that, and it'll basically be like a 30-minute video for each day, and we'll have some crafts that get sent home as well, and some activities that go along with that, just to continue to teach in this time, to teach the Word of God, to teach the Gospel, to the youth of our children of our church, as well as we're going to hopefully be able to get that stuff to the Color Corner as well, and to the children that are there as well. So we'll be developing that, and we'll have some more announcements for that in the coming weeks. But just to let everyone know, that's kind of where we're at with Vacation Bible School, and it'll be a different format, but it'll still be an opportunity to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then that, one last thing, just again, I just want to encourage each family just to remember, each household to remember to pray at 7 o'clock each night or somewhere in that time range, and just to continue to pray for healing from the coronavirus in this time, for the stop of its spread, and then most importantly, to be praying for salvation, that people would turn to the Lord, and also with that, continue to pray for healing for our nation, for reconciliation, for repentance, and just for our nation to come together and be united, united through the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the most important. We want to pray for salvation, that the gospel would go forth in this time, and that would be what ultimately unites us as a nation. All right, I think that's all the announcements I have. So let me invite up Dan, and he's going to just begin our time with a call to worship and prayer. So, yeah.
Good morning, church. Well, it's great to be back with everybody this morning. Great to be back and worship with you here in the house of the Lord. Would you pray with me as we get started this morning, please? All right. Father, we love you. We thank you and we praise you. Lord, right now we just look to you, Lord, and as we do, we pray, Holy Spirit, come. Speak to us through this service. Allow us to get from this what you have for us, even in this short time of just looking into your word. Lord God, we just pray that we can get from it what you have for us to get from it. Lord, we love you. We thank you for, as Pastor said, for this country, for what we got to celebrate yesterday and for the remainder of the week and the freedom that we have. Lord, we're just so grateful, Lord, for it, and as we look to you now, speak to us from your word. We love you, we thank you, and we praise you, and we ask this in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, so I'm going to be sharing from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. 2 Corinthians 3, 16 through 18. It says this: but whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Amen. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. and the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. Amen. Well, church, happy 4th of July. Happy American Independence Day. And, you know, that's what we celebrated yesterday and what we get to celebrate throughout this weekend. And grateful for that. And hopefully you guys had a good time, and very thankful for the sunshine outside. Absolutely. But I'd like to just take this opportunity and this chance that I have to say thanks to all the men and women that have served and risked their lives and still do to this day to protect the freedoms that we have in this country. Very thankful for that. And I just want to ask you guys to please keep your leaders and all the branches of service in your prayers. You know, on the dollar bill, and I looked to check, and it still says on it, "In God we trust." It still says that, "In God we trust." My friends, my prayer for all of us this morning, church, and every day, with all the uncertainty that's going on in the world and that's happening today, that we can put our trust in the Lord, because we can. And I hope and pray that that is what we do. And I encourage all of us this morning and every day to do that, to put our trust in God. You know, may we be able to say, as the bill says, as the dollar bill says, "In God we trust." You know, we have to believe and lean on the gospel, my friends. We do. We have to believe and lean on it. And as Pastor Mark said in his message to us from the newsletter this month, it says, "The gospel is our ultimate solution." The gospel is our ultimate solution. There is freedom wherever the Spirit of the Lord is. Amen. There is freedom. So may we look to the gospel of Christ, church. Look to His word. Allow the Lord to remove the veil. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, make us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. Pray with me, church. Father, we love You. And as we right now, Lord, just come to You and seek You for the remainder of the service, I pray, Lord, that You would speak to us from the word that Pastor Mark has for us this morning. And also, Lord, allow us to receive whatever it is. Lord God, strengthen us, encourage us. I thank You so much, Lord, for the freedom that we get here in this country. But Lord God, for the freedom in You. Lord God, for Your word, for Your gospel, for Your message to us, for the strength that You give us to get through each and every day. Lord God, we give You this time and we thank You for it, Father God. We ask this in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank You, church.
Thank you, Dan. At this time, please stand as you're able, and we'll be singing the hymn, "America the Beautiful," and we'll be singing three verses of that, and the words are on the screen. So please stand as you're able.
Thank you.
may be seated. Yeah. All right, this time we'll come to the Lord in prayer. And are there any just joys that you'd like to share with your church family this morning? Yeah, go ahead, Dee. Yeah, praise God. Yeah, so yeah, we praise God for Yvonne just doing so well at the home and just being a good fit for her and just the joy she's been able to have there. And just praise God for the parade this last week as well, for the residents, just for opportunity to see family members. And yeah, we just praise God for all that, and praise God all for all the workers over there as well, and just the great job they're doing in the midst of all this too. So yeah, praise God. Yeah. Yeah. Anyone else? Anything? Any joys this morning? I know Lisa had passed on, just that she's doing well, and she just praises God for just everything involved with her surgery and everything going on. And just a thank you also to everyone for your prayers and just kind words and cards and just different things that you've done for her in the midst of all that. And I know she's doing well, and Shannon as well. I believe he went home last Sunday, and that I haven't heard that. I've heard that he's doing fine, so I haven't heard anything different. Put it that way, I haven't heard any. You know, no news is good news, right? So all that I've heard is that he's doing well. So continue to pray for Lisa and Shannon both as they recover, and just thank you for your prayers for that. Yeah. Any other joys this morning, or any concerns that you'd like to share with your church family? Yeah, Mary Lou. So yeah, continued prayers for Janet Wissinger, who's in hospice and continues to decline. Just pray for the Lord's peace and Lord's comfort to her. Yeah. Anyone else? Any other concerns? So. Milo's lifting up his praises to the Lord. Amen. Say, yeah, praise God. Good to see you, Milo. You're getting big. So. I'll say a praise. Ashley and I are, Ashley's expecting, so I'll say that. I almost said it earlier today to a conversation in the hallway that was connected to that. Marilyn was talking about something, but anyways, so yeah, so praise God for that. So we're excited about that, and come January, so there you go. Yeah. All right, well, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you and praise you for your great love for us, for your goodness to us. Lord, thank you just that we can know you. Lord, that we have the freedom to be able to pursue you. Lord, that you pursued us, that you sent your Son to die on the cross for us, that we might be free from sin, that we might be delivered. I thank you for the freedom that we have in Christ. Lord, I thank you for your gospel that has saved us, that has transformed our lives, that has turned us from darkness to light. Lord, that has rescued us from death and given us life. Lord, we just rejoice daily in knowing you. Thank you that you've given us the freedom to pursue you, that we are able to know you, that you've revealed yourself to us, you've made yourself known to us, that we can have a relationship with you. And it's not just knowledge in our head, but it's an intimate relationship that you have come into our heart, that you dwell within us, that we have that just that intimate, close relationship with you, Lord. We thank you for that. We can't even fully grasp the depth of how wonderful that is, but may we just continue to daily know just how wonderful it is to know you, to know your Son, Jesus. And as the Philippian passage says, to know the surpassing greatness of Christ Jesus, my Lord. Just may that be our pursuit in life, just daily to know you more. To know your gospel, to know your power for our lives, Lord, and the freedom that you've given us through your Son. Lord, I thank you so much for that, Lord. Just continue daily that we would just daily live our lives in glory and honor of you. Lord, just that we would daily just repent and pursue you. Lord, just recognizing just sin in our own hearts that just needs to continually be removed. Lord, that we would constantly lay those things before you, knowing that you forgive us, that you are faithful and just, that you give us healing through your Son. So Lord, just may we daily live lives that bring you honor and glory as we day by day pursue your Son, and that we just pursue your righteousness, pursue your goodness, that we would just live lives that bring you glory and honor. Lord, I thank you so much for this country, this nation that we live in. We are so blessed to be in this country, to be Americans. We recognize that. We recognize the tremendous blessing that we have, Lord, and we just pray, we lift up our nation to you. We this past few months, we just recognize that have been a challenging stretch of months for everyone in our nation, and also just throughout the world too as well. But we recognize just for our nation, in many ways it pains us just to see the trial that we've been through, just to see the hardships that we're facing, and just the challenging situations, the challenging things that our nation is facing right now. And we recognize just there's a lot of controversy, there's a lot of just swirling questions and things that we can't fully grasp. But Lord, we know that ultimately the healing our nation needs is your gospel. And so we come before you just acknowledging our need for you, acknowledging our dependency on you, Lord. And we pray that it would be true, that in God we trust, that would be true of our nation, that we would turn humbly back before you, surrender ourselves before you as a nation, and seek you first. So we pray for your gospel just to move in our nation, to move in our land, that that your Spirit would go and move in hearts, and just remove that which remove those things that are keeping people from turning to you. Lord, we just ask for a transformation in our country, Lord, and may our eyes also just, may we continue to be transformed in our lives as well, that we would be bearers of your gospel, we'd be bearers of your truth. Just show us how to conduct ourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel in this time. It's a lot of things we're trying to wrestle with and pray with and figure out, but just show us your path for us as ultimately as we are citizens of your kingdom. Lord, just may we proclaim your kingdom in our country. Lord, may we proclaim your gospel. Just continue to guide us each day in how to live in a manner worthy of your gospel, that more and more your gospel would spread and more people would come to know you as Lord and Savior. So Lord, just we ask for your grace to be shed upon us, and just to that you would do a work in our nation, and you bring healing, reconciliation, just in every place where it's needed, through the love of Christ and the love of the gospel. Lord, I thank you so much for just, again, being able to seek you. We just acknowledge we're so blessed to be able to have you as our Lord and Savior, that you daily intercede before us, that your Son intercedes before the Father on our behalf. That is just gives us such confidence, gives us such assurance of our salvation, that you are daily interceding on our behalf. Thank you, Lord, for that. We want to lift up a few just joys and just concerns this morning. We lift up Yvonne. We thank you so much for blessing her life, Lord. Just the timing of being able to move into the home and everything, and just the need she has. Thank you that she's just adapted well to that, and that's been a great fit for her. Just thank you for the joy she's experiencing, and just as she shared, she's just not crying. She's not having those tears. So I thank you for just the way you've worked in her life, and that's been such a great fit for her. Just continue to bless her. Bless all the residents over there as well, as this has been trying, not being able to see family. But just bless them, be near to them, bless all the staff over there, the nurses, and just everyone, the staff in the Wimber Woods and just other places like that as well. Bless them as they care for these people in such a difficult time when they can't see family, but at least they're able to see, nurses and those people who can be a comforting voice to them in this time. So just continue to lift them up as well. Lord, we thank you for Lisa doing well. Just we continue to lift her up, and just for her full healing. Just thank you for watching over her, and just thank you for watching over Shannon as well, and just for the healing for both of them. We just continue to pray for just your work to be done through that, and we give you all the glory and praise for that whole situation, Lord. Lord, and we want to continue to lift up Janet Wissinger, and we just thank you for her, for her faith, for her love for you, Lord. Just I pray that you would strengthen her in this time, just this challenging time for her. Just know her health is not doing well, but we lift her up to you. Just may you draw near to her. May you comfort her. May she know your presence. May she know you just in a more intimate and deeper way as she faces this difficult time. Be with her family as well. Encourage and strengthen them. Draw them near to you and encourage Mary Lou and just others who know her, Lord. So we just lift her up to you, Lord. Father, we just thank you so much for, again, your love for us, your grace. Thank you for working in our lives. Just continue to transform us and work in our hearts. Lord, just may we more and more know you each day. May you fill us with your Spirit, and may we go out to do your work and to share the gospel. Just may we do that in every way in our lives. May we be your beacon of light just in these challenging times that we're in. We pray this, Lord, in Christ's name. Amen. All right, at this time, we'll be just, again, I'll just remind about the offering. Our offering will be in the back on the way out, and you can drop your offering in the plates there. And in a sense, as our offertory this morning, we're just going to be watching a video. It's God Bless America, sung by the Gaither Band, and there's just some different images and things from our country. So we just will be watching that this morning. So God bless America for sure. America for sure is a powerful video and great singing for sure. So we lift that prayer up to the Lord, absolutely. All right, this time we'll be getting into our scripture again. I'm going to read the Philippians 3:1-14 again. Just We began looking at last week, just the first two verses, but I'm going to go ahead and read that section again for us, just as we'll continue to be in this passage for a little while here. So further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision. We who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh, though I myself have reasons for such confidence. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do. Forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. And praise God. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Last week, we began with that passage and just gave an overview on Philippians 3, 1 through 14. And again, we just talked how that reveals the heartbeat of Paul's life. Again, and that heartbeat is just to know the surpassing greatness of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. That's really Paul's heartbeat. Last week, we really only focused in on verses 1 and 2. And in verse 1, we talked about the idea of safeguard, you know, of hearing repeated teachings and truth as a safeguard for us. You know, safeguards, they keep us on the right track. They keep us pursuing the Lord and walking in his truth. And they also keep us alert and on guard against the teachers and lies that turn us away from Christ. And so Paul's reminder to the Philippian church is a healthy reminder to us to measure everything by the word of God and to listen clearly to the safeguards God has put in our lives through his word, through prayer, through his Spirit, and the fellowship of the church. It's a reminder for us, again, to live in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, that we not be led astray. Then verse 2, Paul then, he began to get into, to address the false teachings that some of the Jewish Christians were wrongly forcing upon the Philippian church. You know, there really is a shift in tone in the letter at this point as Paul, he just enters into this strong warning and he rebukes this group as false teachers. And again, he calls them dogs, men who do evil, mutilators of the flesh. Paul is on the attack here. It's definitely a shift in tone in the letter. And his condemnation is so strong. We talked about this a little bit last week, but his condemnation is so strong because this group was distorting the gospel of Christ. You know, they were saying that Christ's sacrifice on the cross was not enough to save from sins, but you also had to keep the law completely, you know, the Old Testament law, which didn't save the Jews one bit. They're saying, but you had to keep that law in order to be a true Christian. You know, they were continuing to stand on Pharisaical purity of keeping the Old Testament law, and they were also forcing Gentiles to become physically like a Jew as well, meaning the Gentiles actually had to be circumcised to be right with God, to be in the church. They had to basically become Israelites, and that's what the Judaizers are forcing upon the Gentile believers. And so Paul rightly denounces this teaching in light of the true gospel of salvation alone through Christ. And that is where we're going to pick up today. So let us pray as we begin. Dear Father, we thank you so much for your love for us, your goodness and grace. Thank you for your word. Lord, just thank you again for your safeguards and your word that you've given us. Thank you for your truth. Lord, as we dig into Philippians more and dig into your truth this week, may you guide us, may your Spirit fill us with your word, and your Spirit fill us with your gospel. In Christ's name, amen. All right, so just the first thought for today, just looking to beginning to get back into this passage, is more than just a religious debate. And so something to think about with this whole issue with the Judaizers and, you know, this group of Jewish Christians forcing the Gentiles to become physically and outwardly like a Jew. While that's definitely a theological religious issue, part of these false Jewish Christians, these Judaizers, part of their insistence was also it was an ethnic thing. They, as Jews, were the chosen people, and the Gentiles, they always, the Israelites in the history of the Israelite nation, they had looked at the Gentiles as dogs, as not worthy of the position that they had as the people of God. So they had had that kind of view for centuries, and that was not a right view. That was not a right view from the Old Testament, from Scripture at all. We looked at that briefly last week, that the Jews were supposed to be a light to the Gentiles, the light to the nations. But the Jews had kind of elevated themselves over other groups, and they saw the Gentiles as dogs, that they were not as good as them. And so when now Paul's writing a letter to this church where you've got Gentiles coming in, you've got different backgrounds, different cultures, all these things meshing together, it was leading to some of these issues. And so this was more than just, it was definitely a theological doctrine issue, absolutely, the truth of the gospel, but it affected their relationships with one another in so many different ways because of all those other factors as well. So the Judaizers, again, they were forcing the Gentiles to meet the Old Testament law, and otherwise they couldn't be in fellowship with them. You know, Gentiles, they're not full Christians like we are. You know, they're not to be in the church. Think about these Judaizers. In their defense, of course, there was a lot for them to overcome. This is a huge transformation for them as well. But because they're clinging to false teaching of the gospel, because they're looking at things through that false teaching and not through the truth of the gospel of Christ, they're looking at the Gentiles through a works righteousness lens. And that's based all on physical characteristics and outward actions. And Paul ran into this constantly and even had to rebuke Peter at one point. And we see that in the letter to the Galatians, where Peter was eating with Gentile believers. You know, Peter, again, was a Jew. He was eating with Gentile believers. But then when some Jewish believers showed up, he started to distance himself from the Gentile believers so as not to fall out of favor with the pure, you know, quote-unquote, pure Jewish Christians. And we see some of that conversation in Galatians. So Paul has spoken to this a lot. And so I just show this just so that he addressed it in a lot of his letters. And in Galatians 2:14, you know, Paul says to Peter, "When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter in front of them all," he confronts Peter. He says, "You are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile," you know, and this is in quotes, "Gentile sinners," and again, that's that reference to that idea of Gentiles being dogs. "And, you know, we who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by observing the law. Because by observing the law, no one will be justified." And so there, you know, Paul is really putting Peter in his place. You're not living out the gospel. You're trying to still justify yourself by observing the law, which, you know, the law only revealed our sin, that we are sinners, that we are incapable of saving ourselves. And you're still clinging to that old way. But that's not the truth of the gospel. The gospel is that Jesus Christ alone has saved us. We've put our faith in him, not these laws and not these outward regulations. And so Paul later goes on to say in verse 20 there of Galatians 2, he says, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing." And that really, again, that's the same thing he's doing in Philippians as well. You know, that if the righteousness could be gained through the law, if we had to follow all these Old Testament things and had to become an Israelite, essentially, then Christ died for nothing. There was no point in him coming if we could do this on our own. And so he's, again, consistently attacking that. And where he says, "I've been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me," that's the same thing as him saying, you know, I count my past rubbish and now I only pursue Christ and the surpassing greatness of knowing him. And so Paul, again, he's constantly running into this issue. And I just wanted to point that out. There's a lot of implications that result from false teaching. And Paul is constantly battling against that because those false teachings lead to a lot of issues in the church. It led to a lot of division. You know, yes, this was a theological, it was a doctrine issue, and it distorted the true gospel of salvation alone in Christ. But the application of that false teaching led to division in the church along ethnic lines as the Judaizer groups were lifting themselves up above the impure Gentiles and the Gentile Christians who outwardly didn't keep the Old Testament law. And now, was this true of all Jewish believers? Were they all doing this? No, they weren't. They were definitely not all doing this. Again, Paul, he's a Jew himself. But there was this, again, this constant, consistent group that trailed Paul around trying to subvert the gospel and the bringing in of the Gentile believers into the body of Christ. They were against that. And so as we move through the passage, recognize just the difficulty of what Paul was struggling with in terms of maintaining unity and proclaiming the truth of the gospel as people from every tribe, nation, and tongue were responding to the gospel, and they brought with them, of course, different cultural backgrounds and differences. You know, Paul as a leader is dealing with a lot of different complicated things. So in this passage, though, Paul, he's going to move through his own background as a Jew and the confidence he once had in that background, and he's going to again cast that aside as rubbish in light of the gospel and the surpassing greatness of Jesus Christ. You know, the gospel of Christ, salvation in Christ alone. You know, it's not really about what we bring to the table. It's about Christ and what he has done to save all, to save the Jew and Gentile alike. And the ground is level at the foot of the cross, and so we surrender all to Christ and put our confidence in him because it's Christ and his gospel, his truth that allows us to stand united in one as the body of Christ. And that's what really Paul is appealing to with these Jew and Gentile groups, is to look to Christ, to the surpassing greatness of Christ. That's what's going to unite us and unify us. Our unity is in him alone. And so we're moving into this passage more. The second thing to look at here is just how our identity is in the gospel. And verse 3 looks at this where it says, "For it is we who are the circumcision, we who worship by the Spirit of God, who glory in Christ Jesus, and put no confidence in the flesh." So there's four statements in there that characterize a believer in the gospel of Jesus Christ. The first one is, we who are the circumcision. And this is a shift from verse 2, where in verse 2, Paul referred to the Judaizers' insistence on circumcision. He referred to that as mutilation, on par with forbidden pagan worship practices. But now he's using that word circumcision in honor. But Paul is applying this term to Christians, regardless of physical background. You know, regardless of if you're a Jew, Gentile, slave, free, a barbarian, Scythian, as he says in one other place in reference to this kind of idea. You know, instead, this is not a physical background issue. It's not what's physically done to the body. You know, the circumcision is a title for the church as the covenant people of God. And therefore, the church are the heirs of all the covenant promises made by God to ancient Israel. You know, the church is the fulfillment of God's plan. Just as Israel is to be a light to the nations, you know, the church is the fulfillment of that. And so the Christian church is the new Israel, and circumcision, which did, you know, of course, it set apart Jews physically, but now circumcision, that title, the circumcision, finds its true depth of meaning in the Christian church as those who have received the true circumcision of the heart that comes by faith in Christ and by the Spirit. Again, Paul addresses this in other places too in speaking of circumcision. And in Romans 2:25, just to elaborate on this point about the circumcision, to try to grasp this, he says in verse 25, chapter 2 of Romans, "Circumcision has value if you observe the law. But if you break the law, you have become as though you had not been circumcised. If those who are not circumcised keep the law's requirements, will they not be regarded as though they were circumcised? The one who is not circumcised physically and yet obeys the law will condemn you, even though you have the written code and circumcision are a lawbreaker." And then here it gets really into the key point. "A man is not a Jew if he is only one outwardly, nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. No, a man is a Jew if he is one inwardly, and circumcision is circumcision of the heart by the Spirit, not by the written code. Such a man's praise is not from men, but from God." And so Paul is getting out there, you know, circumcision is circumcision of the heart by the Spirit. It's a work that's done in your heart by the Spirit of God. It's not something that we just do outwardly to our body that you check that off and say, oh yeah, I can put confidence in that because, you know, I'm a Jew, I've been circumcised. No, it's a work in the heart by the Spirit. And so in that first verse, circumcision has value if you observe the law. Of course, all of us are lawbreakers. So whether you're circumcised or not, the moment you break the law, that circumcision has no value. And so Paul, again, here is talking about how, again, as Christians, and as in the church, you know, we are the circumcision. We are the fulfillment of God's plan, that God has worked in our hearts. He has transformed us through his son, that the reason that we are circumcised in our heart is because of what Jesus has done on the cross. That is where our confidence is to be placed. And so he starts with that. So again, the next characteristic that he moves to of the church of Christians is that he says, we who worship by the Spirit of God. And this is just a sign that the worship of the Christian is intensely spiritual. It's not an outward show. It's not an act. It's not a do this or do that. But it's a personal, intimate relationship with the Spirit of God that overflows in true worship. And Jesus spoke of this in John 4 when he said to the woman at the well, yet a time is coming and that has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. And so worship is of the heart by the Spirit of God. It's not a ritual observance. Worship is instead, it's an intimate thing and it's done in truth. The true believer will first and foremost be broken and contrite, depending fully on the Spirit of God. And also the true church is dependent on the Spirit when it assembles as he inspires truthful worship and not vain religious observance. And again, he's saying this, of course, in contrast to the Judaizers who are building their confidence on physical ritual observance. The third characteristic he says there is that we who glory in Christ Jesus, the third characteristic there. And Paul uses that word glory or exalt. He uses that many times in his letter, and it can be used on two different extremes. The one extreme is proud self-confidence, pride in self, pride in works, glorying in self. Or the other use of that word that Paul uses is humble submission to God's grace, as shown in the cross of Christ. And that's how he's using it here, who glory in Christ Jesus. Paul is using it to mark the true believer as glorying in Christ Jesus alone. The believer rejoices, exalts only in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. Our boasting is not in ourselves, which, be reminded, if we're boasting in ourselves, that is the essence of sin. We're placing pride in ourselves and our own accomplishments. We're placing confidence in ourselves rather than placing confidence in God and rather than being humble before him. So as a Christian, as a true Christian, our boasting is in Christ alone, who alone has saved us. And that statement puts to shame any attitude that glories in anything other than Christ, especially religious merit or works righteousness that sets itself up alongside or above the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ, which alone saves. And that's what the Judaizers are doing. They're setting their works up on par with what Jesus did on the cross. And Paul's saying, no, you can glory only in Christ Jesus alone. Only he has saved you. Your works are nothing. And so the believer, again, has one attitude, an attitude that exalts the sovereign grace of God. We glory in Christ Jesus, not in ourselves. Our confidence is in him and him alone. And then the fourth characteristic really kind of piggybacks off of the third, of glorying in Christ Jesus. And he says, we who put no confidence in the flesh. And here Paul is just making his point super clear. He's rejecting any attempt of humans, of mankind, especially through religion, of gaining a right standing before God. There is no confidence in the flesh. Any attempt to secure by your own effort approval and acceptance with God is ultimately futile. Any claimed confidence outside of Christ stands really in direct opposition to Christ and his finished work on the cross to save you from your sins. And the Judaizers, they were claiming such confidence in their rituals and works. And as a result, they believed they could claim the blessing of God because of this confidence. And the sad thing is that while they were doing that, it reveals that they were really just doing all these things in order to receive the blessing of God rather than actually know him for himself and the joy that is in knowing God. It's essentially they're in the position of the older brother in the parable of the lost son. The older brother who he slaves all the time, for his father. And then when the younger son returns, he's all mad about it. And the father comes out to him and he's, why don't you come in and all these things? And he's like, look, I have worked for you all these years and now you give him the fattened calf. And that just revealed about that man's heart that he just wanted the blessing. He didn't want the actual relationship with his father. He just wanted the blessing. He wanted the things. And that's really where the Judaizers are at. They're saying, our works have basically gained a claim on God, that we have claimed the blessings of God by our actions. And they're missing the truth of the gospel, that we are all desperately in need of Christ. And they've missed out also on the intimacy of knowing the Father, of worshiping him in spirit and truth. John Calvin, a famous theologian back during the Reformation era, he wrote this. He said, "To place one's confidence in anything outside of Christ is to have confidence in the flesh. And this would subvert the gospel and endanger the soul. Therefore, such confidence is to be rejected." And that again, is why Paul's condemnation of these false teachers is so strong, and why verse 3 characterizes, conversely, so strongly the character and standing of true believers before God. You know, again, for the believer, we are the new Israel. We live in the reality of God's promises. We are his covenant people. We worship by God's Spirit and enjoy intimate communion and dependence on God. And we glory and boast in Christ alone, and we place no confidence in the flesh. We placed no confidence in anything apart from Jesus Christ. Again, confidence alone is found in Christ. Placing confidence in anything else is not confidence, but really it's truly illusion. And so moving on from there, Paul, and the third point here to look at here is that Paul plays their game. He kind of enters into the game. And that's what we see in verses 4-6. You know, Paul is going to relate his past and how he used to play the confidence in the flesh rat race, essentially. You know, Paul is going to make very clear his staunch opposition to the Judaizers and their false gospel. And so he starts by recounting his own experience as a Pharisee under the law. Then he's going to move to his conversion experience and then the transformation of his life in terms of what he lost and what he has gained in Christ. And so in verse 4, Paul challenges the Judaizers at their game, at their own game, and challenges them to compare themselves to him. You know, he's basically saying, is there any one of you more qualified than I based on the law and based on being a Jew? And he goes even as far to say, you know, whatever advantage did you think you have by your works, your confidence in the flesh? Well, actually, I have more. And Paul is using his past here purely for the sake of argument, you know, to show himself as an authentic Jew. And as we know from what comes after in the following verses, though, Paul, he's not glorying or boasting in his past, but he's bringing it up only to show the surpassing greatness of Christ as of infinitely greater value than anything else. And so Paul, then, he's going to list off all his credentials. You know, four things that he lists are due to heredity, basically just being born, you know, and that's the situation he was born into. And then three of those credentials are those his by personal choice and then living out those convictions. And as I read this verse always, obviously, you know, he's saying, you know, I'm circumcised in the eighth day, people of Israel, and he just keeps listing them off. He's kind of playing the game here, and he's using an argument. And I kind of sense an air of arrogance in this argument. Not that Paul is arrogant at all. That's not at all. Paul's not arrogant. But when you hear all Paul is saying for the sake of argument, it just smells arrogant. You know, and that's part of Paul's point here, I think. He's just making it sound ridiculous. And he does the same type of thing in his letter to the Corinthians, where he says he's talking like a fool when he speaks in this way for the sake of argument. You know, he's basically just saying it's foolish and arrogant to live with confidence in anything other than Christ. He's saying, I used to do that. I used to have confidence in these things. And all you're doing ultimately is just putting yourself up against one another as more worthy of God's blessing rather than realizing the gospel, realizing your desperate need for Christ, and then surrendering to him. You know, again, Paul's point, overarching point here, is your confidence should be in Christ alone, or because on nothing else can you stand before the judgment seat of God. So Paul is just making this argument for the sake of argument, just to kind of put it to rest, and then let's move on and look at Christ. And so Paul, he's listing them off in succession with a feigned, just kind of prideful air to show how foolish this confidence is. So he starts with circumcision. Basically, he just says, yeah, I was circumcised on the eighth day. You know, I'm a true Jew. I'm a true blood. My parents followed the letter of the law there. I was circumcised on the eighth day. I was a Jew from birth. And so Paul is just starts with that to say, I speak with authority to you Judaizers. You know, you stress so much importance in circumcision. Well, I'm circumcised, so hear me out. Then he goes on to say, you know, I'm of the people of Israel, and he kind of checks that box off. He says, I'm the tribe of Benjamin, you know, a special and honored tribe. You know, I'm named after a king that came from that tribe. You know, he checks that one off too. He says, I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews. You know, basically he grew up in the culture, he knows the language, you know, check. Then he says, in regard to the law, getting into his personal choices in life, in regard to the law, I was a Pharisee. You know, I was part of the strictest sect of Judaism, and I was devoted to the Torah. You know, check that one off too. As for zeal, he says, persecuting the church. Now, this one, I think it really pains Paul to write this one. But he's just, again, showing his zeal for God, even though it was misdirected and misplaced at that time. But he says that basically to check off another box. And then lastly, he says, as for legalistic righteousness, faultless. You know, Paul, basically, he's claiming here that he met the human outward standard of blamelessness. You know, he was, you know, on the outward level, he was faultless, and he checks that one off too. You know, so really there was nothing Paul missed. He checked all the boxes, but in all these things, he goes on to say there was no confidence. This was all an illusion. It was all a lie. And so verse 7, where it says, you know, but whatever was to my profit, I now consider lost for the sake of Christ. You know, Paul is basically saying, you know, all which I thought to be a profit to me was, it was really an illusion. And I now consider them lost for the sake of Christ. And Paul isn't just merely dismissing his past and the way he lived. But if one theologian suggests that he's rejecting them with horror, and he treats them as a liability. You know, he really looks on them with horror in his life, that they were a liability to him and a danger to his soul. And verse 8 reemphasizes that, and he says, what is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him. And he's just expanding on the tremendous waste of everything he's lost compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus his Lord, for whose sake he has lost all things. Now, just Paul is not outright rejecting, you know, who he is. And he's not rejecting all of his past. You know, nothing, there's nothing wrong with his writing, nothing wrong with being born a Jew, nothing wrong with being raised in that culture. He's not saying that at all. What he's saying, though, is that his error was in his choice to place confidence in all those things rather than walking in surrendered faith to God and trusting in God for salvation. He was trusting in all those things for his salvation. I've earned my salvation. And that's what his great error was. And he said, that is a waste. Instead, I needed to look to God and walk in faith and trust in what he provided through his son. And so again, Paul, he's not rejecting being a Jew. That's not, he's, you know, he had no choice over that. He's proud of that heritage, absolutely. And you see that in other letters. He has a longing for his people to come to the Lord. You know, it's okay to be proud of that. But where it's wrong is to place confidence in those things as being necessary for his salvation. And that's what he's getting at here. So within all that, Paul, he leaves no room for boasting in anything other than Christ. You know, there's no confidence outside of him. And we all live by the grace of God. Our confidence needs to be in him alone. And so just in closing here, just some closing thoughts, are there ways that you are putting confidence in the flesh? I think that's something we all need to look at. Are there ways that we have putting confidence in the flesh, and confidence in ourself, confidence for anything? You know, are we putting confidence in ourself for our happiness, for our joy, for our contentment? Are we putting our happiness, are we putting confidence in our flesh for earning our salvation or earning our reputation, any of those things? It's so easy to put confidence in self rather than humbly submitting to God and his call for your life. You know, are you trusting in anything other than Christ? I think that's really what this passage is getting at. You know, that Christ alone is where our confidence lies. It is in him alone that we look to. And so I think one way to look at this sometimes, to look at our lives just to challenge ourselves, you know, what are things that we sacrifice for? What are things that we boast in? Is it in Christ or is it in something else? And I think we really need to look at that. Are we sacrificing for Christ or are we sacrificing for ourselves? That's something we need to honestly ask ourselves and be convicted by. You know, the Judaizers and Paul himself in his past, you know, he was confident in his flesh. He was confident in his works, his efforts, all those things. And they, the Judaizers and Paul himself, they sacrificed a lot to live by such confidence. And yet, as Paul says, it was rubbish. It was a waste. It was loss. Francis Chan has this challenging quote. He says, our greatest fear should not be a failure, but at succeeding at things in life that don't really matter. And I think that's the false confidence game. You know, we put our confidence in things that don't really matter. And we need to be challenged to put our confidence in Christ alone. You know, all sacrifice, success, human achievement or human standing, status or human-based value, all of that, any confidence outside of Christ will not last and does not matter for eternity. They are a liability in your life that keep you from knowing Christ and his surpassing greatness. So as you read this passage and hear this, you know, be reminded, you know, have as a safeguard for you, place your confidence in Christ alone. You know, glory in Jesus Christ alone. Boast in him alone. You know, worship by the Spirit of God that he has placed within you. And also as the church, live by the promises of Scripture that are given to you as his child. And so just in closing, just let us fix our eyes on Jesus, for everything else is a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus your Lord. Don't get caught looking on the horizontal level. Always be looking vertical, putting your confidence in Christ alone, boasting in him alone, and living the gospel out in that way. Let us pray as we finish. Dear Father, as we looked at this passage, there's a lot going on in it. There's a lot of challenging things to think through. But Lord, we first and foremost just rejoice that you love us, that you delight in us, Lord, that you sent your Son to die for us, Lord, that you just have called us to be your own. I thank you that we can pursue you, that we can know the surpassing greatness of your Son, that we can know the difference the gospel makes in our lives, that we can experience that transformation. Lord, just may that be true in our lives. May we put our confidence alone in you. May we wrestle with that. If there's anything we are putting confidence in that is not you, may we reject that. May we see that as a great liability in our lives. Lord, that we would turn alone to you, that we would pursue you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. May that be our heartbeat. Lord, just show us what that looks like in our lives as well as we continue to consider the thought of what does it mean to live in a manner worthy of the gospel. May we be true to you. May we be true to living in that manner. So Lord, just may we glory in you alone. May we boast in you alone. May we stand in confidence on Jesus Christ. May we not put anything else in our lives that would come in between that confidence. Lord, I thank you that we can be confident in you. Thank you that you've saved us, you've delivered us. You, again, are interceding for us, that we have assurance of our salvation. May we walk forward just confident fully in your Son, and may we live our lives to your glory and honor. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. All right. As we close, let us sing just another patriotic hymn, just a great hymn. By the Battle Hymn of the Republic, we'll be singing verses 1 and 4. And as one of the lines in there says, he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free. Let us be about that. Let us live the gospel out in that way, that people may be free and be free from their sin and know Christ. All right, please stand as you're able. Pleasure to be with you this morning again as we worship our Lord and Savior. As you depart as well, remember the offerings are in the back in the lobby, and also just kind of try to depart from the back forward. And we'll look forward to seeing you next week. Have a great week. Let us lift our hands up in prayer as we close. Dear Father, we thank you again so much for your great love for us. Thank you that we have confidence because of your Son and because of his finished work on the Christ. May we live in the midst of that confidence as we boldly proclaim your gospel. Lord, just bless our nation. May your gospel spread in our land. May hearts be surrendered to you, and may we turn to you for help. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Go in peace. We love you. God bless.